introduced in-house, April 15, 2016. Directed Energy Weapon Systems Acquisition Act of 2016.
Hello, I trust you are well. My name is Peter Kirby. I am a staff writer with ActivistPost.com. I have been researching and writing about chemtrails for many years now. I have uncovered enough information to be able to put together a brief history of the global weather modification project which produces the lines so often seen in today's skies. A rough, illustrated history is presented here. In the information posted below this video, you will find links to my website, my latest article, and my book, Chemtrails Exposed, A New Manhattan Project. Chemtrails Exposed, the book, provides much more in-depth discussions. There is a covert global weather modification project currently operating in mostly NATO countries. This project involves aircraft, dispersed particles, electromagnetic energy, and a command and control apparatus. Aircraft disperse the particles, then the particles are manipulated with electromagnetic energy in order to modify and control the weather. Through historical American weather modification documents and many other reputable sources, one can derive the history of this project going back to at least 1946. This project is what I call the New Manhattan Project, or NMP. The NMP probably began with Nikola Tesla. Nikola Tesla was a pioneer in the practical use of electromagnetic energy, conceiving of a way to control the weather in the fashion of the New Manhattan Project would be right up his alley. Although he did experience relatively brief periods of wild success, fame, and fortune, later in life he ended up broke. Even in his later poverty, he continued to theorize. He wrote lots of these ideas down. When he died, huge amounts of his papers were confiscated by the government. G-men searched through his papers looking for anything which would be of value to our military. Although what was later released to the public did not contain any documents showing Tesla's hand, a concept for the New Manhattan Project may have been among these confiscated documents, discovered by the government investigators and put under classification. 3 years after Nikola Tesla's death in 1946, three scientists from General Electric Laboratories simultaneously launched the modern era of weather modification and the New Manhattan Project. Their names were Irving Langmuir, Vincent Schaefer, and Bernard Vonnegut. Of these three, Bernard Vonnegut was the most important. The modern, overt weather modification industry began when Bernard Vonnegut discovered that small silver iodide particles attract atmospheric water. Silver iodide was then dispersed from aircraft, and today's cloud seeding industry was born. The conventional cloud seeding industry is distinct from the New Manhattan Project, and therefore is not the focus of this video. The New Manhattan Project employs electromagnetic energy to manipulate dispersed particles, while conventional weather modifiers do not. Also, conventional weather modification efforts are conducted on a regional basis, while the New Manhattan Project is global. Lastly, the New Manhattan Project employs wholly different dispersed materials. Not only did he start the conventional cloud seeding industry, but Bernard Vonnegut also went on to bear the new Manhattan Project's standard. In the late 1940s and throughout the 1950s, Vonnegut led what are called space charge experiments. Space charge experiments involved unsheathed stainless steel wires miles long, strung from the tops of tall wooden poles or between mountain peaks. These wires were connected to a strong DC power supply, which made the wires emit coronal energy. The coronal energy emitted by these wires interacted with atmospheric particles, both ambient and artificially dispersed. The coronal discharge's effects upon these atmospheric particles were monitored and analyzed. If you are wondering, yes, Bernard Vonnegut was related to the novelist Kurt Vonnegut. They were brothers. The space charge experiments of the 40s and 50s demonstrated the feasibility of influencing atmospheric particles with electrical energy. The next step was to use electromagnetic energy at longer distances. This was probably accomplished beginning in the late 1950s at a site in northern Wisconsin and Michigan known as Clam Lake. The activities at the Clam Lake facility involved, like the earlier space charge experiments, miles of unsheathed stainless steel wires strung from the tops of telephone pole-like poles. Except this time, the wires were designed to produce electromagnetic pulses. What has been declassified about these activities is that the electromagnetic pulses produced by the wires at Clam Lake were used for communications with distant submerged submarines. Much of the activities at Clam Lake remain classified. It is the author's educated speculation that the electromagnetic signals produced by the wires at Clam Lake were also used for weather control experiments involving the manipulation of atmospheric particles. Details are in the book. Also in the 1950s, the new Manhattan Project's command and control apparatus was taking shape. Something called the SAGE anti-aircraft system began development in the early 1950s. This system involved the remote control of about 30 missile-like aircraft designed to destroy incoming intercontinental ballistic nuclear missiles. This SAGE system went on to spawn mobile aircraft control systems capable of remotely controlling over 1,000 airplanes. Your author's learned speculation is that today's chemtrail aircraft are remotely controlled from a central location, and it was this SAGE system that eventually evolved into today's new Manhattan Project command and control apparatus. In 1966, the first type of advanced instrument known to be able to produce electromagnetic energy capable of influencing atmospheric particles and therefore the weather was realized at Pennsylvania State University. This type of instrument is known as an ionospheric heater. By 1974, two other ionospheric heaters were realized at Arecibo, Puerto Rico, and in Armdale, New South Wales, Australia. It is significant to note the location of these instruments and their predecessors, because the disbursement of atmospheric particles for the purpose of continued New Manhattan Project development was probably conducted as well in their surrounding areas. The experimental chemtrail spraying planes probably accompanied the ionospheric heaters. The aircraft command and control facilities were mobile. Alaska appears to have been the home of much of the New Manhattan Project's development. The first known ionospheric heater from Pennsylvania was later moved to Poker Flat, Alaska. By 1986, Alaska was also the home of another ionospheric heater called the High Power Auroral Stimulation Observatory, or HIPAS. Construction of the infamous High Frequency Active Auroral Research Project, or HARP, facility in Gakona, Alaska, began in 1993. Today, HARP is the world's most powerful and most versatile ionospheric heater. The permanent aircraft command and control apparatus may have been built into the North American Aerospace Defense Command, otherwise known as NORAD, facilities in Colorado. Large-scale domestic spraying operations began in the mid-1990s. Details of the New Manhattan Project's development and execution can be found in the book Chemtrails Exposed, A New Manhattan Project. The NMP is systematically broken down in chapters covering the details of every aspect of this project, such as the ionospheric heaters, the chemtrail aircraft, the chemtrail sprays, command and control, motives, biological impacts, other agendas, the information war, persons and organizations of interest, solutions, and more. Please visit the author's website, peteracurby.com, where you will find links to a webpage where one may purchase a copy of Chemtrails Exposed, available exclusively at Amazon.com and the Create Space eStore. Thank you.